Good morning, church. This is unscheduled. This was not something I had planned on doing, but read a good word this morning, and it hit me, and I just wanted to share it. And in full disclosure, this comes from my classwork. I'm only taking one class this semester at Southeastern, and it's a class that was put together by Chuck Lawless. And Dr. Lawless wrote this, it's a devotional kind of workbook study guide, called Putting on the Armor, and I'm way behind on it. I've got to finish it up this week, and I've got 2 weeks worth to do, but I read this one particular passage, just wanted to share it with you. I believe that one of the biggest problems that we have in the church today is that we have too small of a God, and I believe that Lawless, he really absolutely nails it in this section where he's talking about the sword of the Spirit. I just want to read to you one paragraph and give you a couple verses and maybe a few thoughts. He says this. He says, this is the heading. The Word teaches us that God is sovereign over the enemy. We are in a real battle against the enemy, but the enemy has never, never been outside of God's control. Even when he is face to face against us, he is still on God's leash. And that's how we should picture Satan, is limited in power. He is on God's leash, as he says. If this truth is difficult for you to accept, think about these biblical examples. Satan attacked Job, but he could only go as far as God allowed him. In one of Zechariah's visions, God would not allow the accuser to condemn Joshua the high priest. The demons exorcised from the demon-possessed man at the Gadarene tombs could only go where Jesus permitted them. Satan had to ask permission from God to attack Peter. Paul, he struggled with a thorn in the flesh that he called a messenger of Satan, but God determined whether that thorn would or would not be removed, which, by the way, it was not. Now, how does this truth help us when we are under attack? First, God always has a greater purpose for us when he allows the enemy to attack us. I'll say that again. God always has a greater purpose for us when he allows the enemy to attack us. He uses battles to conform us to the image of Christ. Now, I dare say that many of you can think of your own lives and think of examples where that is something that's happened, where in your weakness you are made strong in your faith in Christ. And that conforming happens as warfare forces us to depend on God for our strength. Second, the enemy doesn't strike us with random attacks. His attacks are not random. Nothing that happens in this world is random. Although he may not realize it, his attacks somehow fit into God's sovereign plan. Now listen to this. What the enemy means for evil, God means for good. And of course, that comes from the story about Joseph. You will recall how Joseph was sold into slavery after being attacked by his brothers. And when Joseph meets his brothers all those years later, and he has been appointed second in command, and basically the known world at that time was saved because Joseph was put in that position in Egypt, he tells his brothers, he says, what you meant for evil. So in other words, this is something that they meant of their own free will. He says, God meant, which means that God meant it of his own free will. What you meant for evil, God meant for good. So I think that as we navigate these uncertain times, that everybody's put out a statement on coronavirus, and I have not done that. I said you'll have to see your doctors for that sort of thing. But this is what I do know: God is completely and totally in control. Now you might ask me, say, well, what would you say to that if you found out that you contracted coronavirus today? And I would tell you, God is completely and totally in control. Now I realize that I'm in the age bracket of people that are often not greatly adversely affected by this virus. But I'll tell you this, I'm the type of person I know there are a lot of people, they can get the flu and they got five kids, they keep taking care of them, and they go to work every day. I can get the common cold and it can ground me for 3 days. I have no guarantee that if I do get this virus that I will live. But this I know, that if it is my time to go, it's my time to go, and I can trust in that. And that does not mean that I make light of death. This virus has taken many lives already, and it seems all projections are that it will take many, many more. But I want to read you a couple verses, and this comes from the Gospel according to Matthew, and it says this. It says, "And fear not them which kill the body, but are not able to kill the soul, but rather fear him which is able to destroy both soul and body in hell." Are not now listen. Some people would tell you that that might refer to the devil. But I'm going to tell you what, the devil does not have the power to send anybody to hell. God alone does. So this is saying to fear God. Just saying, don't fear the things which can only kill the body. And by the way, all bodies die. There is a certainty in life, and that is that we will all cease to live if the Lord tarries. And some die young, some die old. I'll share a quick story with you about the sovereignty of God. And by the way, if you don't think this is speaking about God, the follow-up verses are not two sparrows sold for a farthing, and one of them shall not fall on the ground without your Father. So this, again, is some verses that paint God as almighty, all-powerful, and in complete control over all things. Now, the other day, my wife left me with Naomi. She just came in to change Johannine's diaper. And I was out. I was finally doing some yard chores. And by the time Allison got back out there, I had lost Naomi. And evidently, with one of our puppies, she had wandered off into the woods. And so I yelled for her, looked around. But it didn't take real long before I felt fear. I felt panic setting in. I had lost my two-year-old. And I knew that she probably went downhill. And I also knew that there was a ditch full of water. And I ran down there just as fast as I could. And I didn't find her, and my heart started racing, and as I saw water in that ditch, I thought about some friends of mine that they lost a two-year-old that way, and I ran up the hill, and I thought about friends that had lost little ones in many different ways. I know a lot of people that have had to say goodbye to little ones, and I prayed to God in this moment of panic, and I was running as fast as I could run, and I was shouting, I was looking for my little one, and I just prayed to God. I said, God, I said, give me back my baby. I can't live without her. And then I realized that that was not a true prayer, and I said, well, yes, I could live without her. I said, but I don't want to. And I said, God, bring me to my baby. And I kept running, and I kept looking. I finally, in desperation, I told my wife, I said, call 911. We're going to need some people to help us look. And I want to say thank you to the Montgomery County Sheriff's Department, who was so quick to respond. And I'm thankful that we didn't need them. As I crested over the hill back behind our house, I yelled for my little girl, and I heard her say, Daddy. And one more time of that, and I was able to find her. But I want you to know that in all that, while there was so much uncertainty and there was so much I did not know, I did not doubt for a second God's sovereign power. And I was leaning completely on Him. And that's the way that we should be in all of our lives. And so often, I'm so guilty of wanting to trust in myself. And I know that probably many of you struggle with this. And it's only when we get to that point where we are completely at the end of our rope, and we know that we don't have any options in ourselves, that then we look to God, who is almighty and all-powerful. And so at this time when this virus is sweeping not across the country, but the world, and there is so much uncertainty about life, I would remind you that life is uncertain, always, for young and for old. And again, I'm not incompassionate in saying this. This is just the way it is. And so I think that we have a couple reasonable responses to that. All of those responses, humbling yourself, repenting, trusting in God, not leaning on your own understanding, but whatever response that is biblical that you come up with, they all hinge on one great truth about God, and that is that He is sovereign, completely and totally in power. And I would encourage you to go read those Bible stories that we mentioned, or that Dr. Lawless mentions in this devotional. One of my great heroes in the faith is R.C. Sproul. Man, he saw a big God, and he preached a big God. And he says this: if there is one maverick molecule, now this would include a virus, one maverick molecule in all the universe, then God is not sovereign. If there is one maverick molecule, then God is not sovereign. And if God is not sovereign, He is not God. God is either Lord of all, or He is not Lord at all. That's the way I heard one Baptist preacher put it when I was a young boy. And this is a fact of God, that He is completely and totally God. That is all it means to say that God is sovereign. And so I would encourage you today, whatever your thought life is, whatever you're dealing with, wherever life finds you, I would encourage you to recognize that God is completely and totally sovereign over all things. All things. And when you begin to see God this way, you will really lean on Him. You will really begin to trust in Him. You'll realize He's all you've got. And so I would just encourage you, church, to recognize that God is sovereign. Now, what I did not say is that you will not get the virus. I never said that. I didn't say God will prosper you. I didn't say that you can bend God to your will. That wouldn't make Him sovereign. That would make you sovereign. I'm not telling you not to pray. I've prayed for protection for myself, for my family, for my church, for my friends. But God is completely and totally sovereign. And I'll share with you a verse that comes from the book of Revelation that is awesome. And if you can put this in your heart and let it be what guides you to see God, the verse, it comes from Revelation 19 and verse 6, I think it is. It says, "And I heard, as it were, the voice of a great multitude, and the voice as many waters, and the voice as mighty thunderings, saying, Alleluia, the Lord God omnipotent reigns." You see, the throne in heaven is occupied, and Jesus Christ is King over all creation. The spiritual realm, the physical realm, the seen, the unseen, He is completely and totally in control. And so, in these uncertain times, when there's so much that's weighing on the hearts of so many, I would encourage you to worship God as almighty, as all-powerful, as omnipotent, as ruling and reigning. He's not laying down on the job. He's not caught off guard. He's never surprised. And this is the hope that we have in the God of the Bible. I speak of the God of the Bible. It's the only one I know. And I would dare say that for many Christians, including many Baptists, your God is too small. You need to see God as He presents Himself as completely and totally sovereign. Anyway, I don't know how many of you might watch this or what it might mean to you, but if it touches one, then that's enough. This really blessed my heart this morning. I just wanted to share it with you. God rules over all. He is completely and totally in control. And by the way, the Bible, it gives many prophecies of things that are going to look like nightmares, to be perfectly honest. And in those times of complete disaster and utter turmoil, God is reigning and ruling and in complete control. And anyway, God bless you. I hope that you can rest in knowing that God is absolutely sovereign. Amen.